Thank you. And thank you for being a sport, and thank you for you, those of you who made a bid for Per's sweater. Love it. Yes, I'm Mats Grandt from the Norwegian Refugee Council. I've been there for 12 years, and I'm going to talk about passwordless as a way to authenticate with something you have or something you are, and without the coveted something you know piece of it. So first, I want to give you some context and background for the environment that we work in. So we are an old humanitarian organization, 70 years plus, and we help people who are forced to flee from violence and conflict around the world. Last year, there were more than 70 million people who were forced to flee and leave their homes. And the trend is abnormal, I'm afraid to say. It's just peaking. This is the chart for the last 10 years. The NRC, we helped 8.5 million people last year. And we do six core competencies. We do food security, WASH, which is water, sanitation, and hygiene, shelter, which means either temporary shelter or semi-permanent if you, the camp situation prolongs, and permanent shelter where it's a resettlement or re-establishing of societies. And one that is a bit unique for us is our legal unit, ICLA, where we help people who may have fled without papers. So re-establishing citizenship, property owner rights, for example. The victor lives in your house. How do you claim back your property? Education is a big thing for us. We have over 1 million students in our schools across the globe. And finally, we also have a camp management. So we are around 14,000 people who are working in 33 countries from Venezuela to Myanmar. And we have today around 150 offices distributed across these countries. One of the constraints we have is electricity. So this is just a snapshot from a continent, but as you know, electricity is the foundation of everything else. Yeah? Technology, internet, computers, etc. So without electricity, you don't really have the infrastructure required to run an enterprise. So we need to bring that where it doesn't exist. We need to create electricity, we need to create the internet, pulling it down from space at high cost and high latency and low capacity. And it also dictates what kind of equipment our staff brings to the work. One thing is the laptop we bring to them, but smartphones or phones even. Why do you have a phone? There's no cell network. Yeah, so that has an implication. And even though, if you look here, this is Nigeria, which is in the 25 to 50%, so that's not too bad, is it? Well, most of the businesses in Nigeria rely on their own power because national power is so poor. So many examples of this, where even though the charts look okay, this is decent, it isn't really. Yeah? And this is access to bandwidth. In kind of capacity. And if you imagine we are here in the black belt, mostly. Yeah? So access to internet in general is challenged. I need to jump out of this for to do the next one, which is tapping into to what they spoke about during the opening of the keynote, that we can enjoy internet in mostly freedom, where you see a huge portion of the world is under censorship and control. And you see that the yellow ones, they are moving more towards not free than they are moving towards free. That is the trend we see, that governments, when they get access to technology, starts to censor and control their population. And that has an effect for us as well. So this is recent from three countries. This is Iran, that was down for close to 10 days where the domestic and international internet traffic in the country was just completely shut down to stifle civil unrest. We see the same in Venezuela, and we see the same in Iraq. Iraq has been a bit smarter about it, so during business hours, they crank up the capacity again. So that's the peaks throughout the week. Yeah? So these countries have the capability to completely silence a country. And that affects us hugely when we operate in that environment and our all computing stuff is outside the country. Right, next one I want to cover is our MFA journey. We have been doing MFA like forever. And we started out with an application as a service provider in a data center in Norway, where Citrix was the access for the head office people. And the rest of NRC was local driven. So that was what we had then until we started our centralization project, where we built our own access system and entry point into the data center using classic VPN, but still retaining the MFA components with the desktop app, mobile app, and SMS as kind of the authentication factors. That didn't scale very well from a cost perspective in an organization like us. So in 2016, we moved to the cloud. That was our first step. We got Okta as an identity provider to glue that hybrid on-prem and cloud environment and to be able to transition off the data center. And now you know the technical background and context for us, so you understand that for MFA tokens today for us is a security question because nobody has a phone, so you cannot receive anything or use an app. And we don't have a desktop authenticator. So that's a security question. SMS, because that works most of the time, but there are issues. We are subscribing to cell phone operators who aren't kind of part of the good, cozy come through of GSM operators in the world, so messages tend to also not come through. We have the OTP apps, Okta's own, and we also support Google Authenticator and the like. And we have Okta's push app, and now also we support WebAuthn. And that is the kind of thing down here that we have been waiting for, that this gains real momentum so we can get off this legacy authenticators. So this is our passwordless journey. So we had a invite only for the IT staff in head office in August, and then we extended to all of ICT in NRC later in September. And then everyone in NRC was invited to opt in. And we announced it on the workplace internally, and so kind of a fest of positive feedback. People who opted in generally liked it. But we are 7,000 users in our system. So from the workplace fest to the reality, yeah, 160 people signed up for it so far. That's okay, because it is immature. And we're going to point out some of the immaturities we see as we go along. But that is kind of the main challenge, and that's why we are not pushing it heavily in the organization, because we understand that it won't necessarily work for everyone right now. So survey time. So to get some feedback for this conference. And one funny fact or item is the anti-phishing engine in Office 365 censored my survey on passwordless. So I had to go to the administrator and say, can you please whitelist my survey? All right, so we got some responses, and most of them are using, and some of them hadn't heard about passwordless at all until they got the survey. So that's information as well. And most of them are medium users, like kind of log on 2 to 4 times a day. I'm in high, so I'm in 8 and more because I have a zillion identities in the system. And this one is interesting. Most of the people are satisfied with the passwordless experience. And some, but not the same amount, say that they save time or the account is more secure. So one thing is messaging from us, trying to explain them what this technology is. Another one is when you are not in the passwordless scheme, you can get a 24 hours MFA grace on your device until you are challenged again. With passwordless, you're challenged every time. If you have an inconvenient authentication factor, then your signing becomes inconvenient because you have to use that inconvenient factor every time. So that was a learning for us. And someone also said, they will not recommend the passwordless to a colleague if they were asked. So that's fine. Information for us to work with when we reiterate the service further on. The majority of people did not experience issues. Some of them experienced issues that they know about and can work around, and someone entered into problems that they could not get out of. And that would be that if you use Windows Hello as an authenticator, that works very well in the browser. So when you do that, when you try to move from security question to Windows Hello, you can authenticate through the web. But remember, typically these places are the places with low infrastructure. So they tend to use Outlook app and OneDrive app and any app as possible, please. So they sign in and get that token for the app, so they don't need to authenticate again for a while. So WebAuthn does not work with built-in browsers. So on macOS, on Windows 10, etc., we struggle with using WebAuthn tokens to authenticate with Outlook, OneDrive, and so on. So we know it works in Windows 20 H1. It works. So Microsoft knows the secret sauce. So I'm just trying to get Microsoft to get it out. Yeah? We want to leverage that. But that's the state of it today. Okta's own app for mobile access to the web interface does not support passwordless. And if support clears your MFAs, your MFA tokens, you're dead in the water. You cannot enroll again. Most of the people, and this is interesting, because when we are launching stuff, we always think of services like Google and Facebook, etc., who has a tremendous user base and very little support. So I guess no one among yourselves have ever called Facebook support or Google support to get on their service. So usually you figure it out yourself, or you have peers who help you on board. I am the go-to person for my mother-in-law, for example, when it comes to Facebook. Yeah? So in the same, in the workplace, people tend to kind of de-empower themselves and leave stuff and say, this is IT. Yeah? So what we're trying to do is empower people and say, you know, if you are stuck, lift your head and look around. Able to help? Is everyone stuck, or can you actually ask your colleague for help? And is your colleague able to help you, just like they do with private stuff? So I'm very happy about that one. And this one is also great. Who knows, remembers their password? So 5 people say, I have forgotten it. And more people wrote it down, which I'm happy they did, because that's what I told them to do, because they will forget it. Some of them are storing it in the native web browser, which is not good. Some of them are using password manager, but moving people to a password manager is challenging. Yeah? So we are looking into it, but we don't have a good recipe for that. If we do, I get back. So what does it mean when we switch to passwordless? So we move from the classic username, password, and then an authenticator sequence to a sequence where we start with the username, and then you present your authenticator. And based on the authenticator's strength, we will or we will not challenge you for the password. So as you see, the Okta Verify push notification and the built-in authenticator, this is WebAuthn, so that branches out to Windows Hello and Mac OS Touch ID, and security keys. These we have evaluated to be strong enough to do, then you sign on. Yeah. If you present an OTP, an SMS, then we will challenge you for the password. If you are in the deep shit, this won't help you at all. I'll get back to that. But it's the way we do today, right? We are not worse off. Yeah? But this is improvement. So people who have access to this can use this. And you know, you can use Windows Hello on your laptop because that is already available and convenient for you. And when you are on your mobile phone and need to authenticate, you use the app. So you can pick and choose factors pertaining to the context and situation and device you are in. Since we're talking about passwords, here's our password policy. So it's been 14 characters or more since we did that centralization project, so that's 2012. And with the adoption of Okta, we could set some more parameters like no parts of your name or username. And now we also can do that check against have I been pwned for 2,000 of the most popular passwords. And I'm also looking forward to the day when we can say that it will not expire. So it's 180 days today, and we have some legacy left that is preventing us to kind of from December. It lasts forever, but we are getting there. So fingers crossed, come December, I can also share the good news. All right. I guess most of you know this chart and the relative strengths between factors. So you have the weak ones over here. And this is our plans then for the authentication factors that we're going to go forward with. So security question is going to go away. Passwords, I'm going to come back to that, is going to exist for a while. But in what form? That we don't know yet. SMS, voice, and email. We don't use voice and email, so it's SMS. Software OTP. We will drop support for Google Authenticator. And the Okta app itself has a push, and it's also an OTP. So it will remain. So that's why. Push will be there, and then everything under the sun that WebAuthn can offer us. Yeah. So let's take a dive into the man in the middle machine. So this was a big thanks to BDO Cybersecurity because they thought they were going to donate 1 hour's time to us because of what an easy scheme Office 365 Evil Engine X setup. But no, we use Okta. So they graciously accepted to spend a full day for this. So this is our sign-on in the man-in-the-middle machine. And if you are awake, had your coffee, and are sitting back, you will notice that URL is off, and your browser is telling you haven't been here before. But if you are rat-racing, like most of our staff does, I guess they won't notice. And I can't fault them for that. They are so spaced out most of the time when it comes to what they need to do. So at least that is how it looks like. And then we try the verify push, and it survives. Authentication just breaks and will not proceed. And we do the same for the security key, and we have the same. Authentication breaks and will not proceed. We just get gibberish error messages, and the system log doesn't really tell us that this is going on. So that was a bit disappointing. We were hoping for that so we could have some log entry telltales that our staff was being pushed into the man-in-the-middle machine. But no, so that's the state of it today. New device detection didn't trigger. So of course, if you do OTP and password, the man-in-the-middle machine wins. And no new device, because the man-in-the-middle made sure that the traffic were passed on from the original browser to the backend. So the staff member will not get that notification that a new device has signed on to their account. And then the second flaw, if you are then a victim of a man-in-the-middle. If you then launch your Office 365, for example, because it's very boring to be in Okta, so then the man-in-the-middle will capture your session. And then you drag that session out and put it on a different computer. Still no new device detection. Yeah. Because then this browser tab will access Office 365 directly with the authentication token it has gotten, which is valid. So there's no rechecks between Okta and 365 anymore. So that's the danger with the man in the middle and weak authenticators. All right. So let's see if I can pull this off. You know, so what I'm going to do is highlight the thing around password and elevation. So I showed you the current scheme, but what we can also do, which is a bit buggy at the moment, so that's why we haven't put it in production, is to escalate according to risk. Yeah. So now, in this browser, on my profile, I've signed in from this location before. So nothing is new. It's the same old device, same old location. So I approve the push, and yes. Step one succeeded. So that is passwordless sign-in when everything is in good order. So let me sign out again. Now I need my glasses. And let's do an impossible travel and move to Spain, almost in the speed of light. So now I have a new location, new IP, and I also broken velocity rules. So again, the sequence is always MFA, always MFA. The benefit of this sequence, and even though if you are using weak MFA factors, the benefit of this sequence is that people don't get to attempt or have a go at your password until you break the MFA. So password spraying, brute forcing, and all that stuff is out. Yeah, and even though you have the password, you need to break the MFA. So it reduces your threat landscape significantly just by swapping the sequence of how you use your authenticators. Okay, see, now it asks for my password. And now I need to pick the right one. All right, so that was medium risk. Yeah. So let's see if I can do a high risk. So I need again to travel at the speed of light to Paris. And then I'm now entering with a new device, new browser and everything. I need to do one thing more. Okay, should be ready now. Now, since this is test and me and everything, the only thing that is allowed now is two strong authenticators. So I'll start with my security key. And then I finish off with the push. So that was high risk. So now we use two strong authenticators to let someone authenticate through a high risk sign-in. And that worked. Excellent. So what I wish for now is that WebAuthn authenticators to be broken up in their individual pieces. What I cannot do today is break up Windows Hello with a YubiKey, because they both currently belong to the same authenticator pool, WebAuthn. That is a product design issue with Okta. So I know they will get to it. But again, these early days issues, we could have been further ahead, but we aren't. And see if I can do the fourth one. I just need to sign out of this one. And if I go to this one, just waiting for it to connect. All right. So let's see. No. Okay, sorry. It was supposed to go 403, access forbidden. That happened to me when I used that node last time. So that was, we also have automatic blocking of known bad and Tor exit nodes, etc. So if you're coming in from an IP that is associated with malicious activities, we will give you a 403. So we don't even get to attempt to sign on. But live demos, you know. All right. I said we were going back to the password. And when is a password a password? So say, today we are ridden with legacy still. Even though we can do this passwordless authentication in the cloud, etc., we still are riddled with on-prem, Radius, LDAP, legacy auth, etc. Luckily for us, we are shutting down the data center in December, so we get rid of all that. So we will not have that. So we are ready to just say bye-bye to anything that is legacy and say, okay, what is this password that we're going to challenge people with? Yeah? Should it still be 14, 16 characters, blah, 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 and can a shitty password, like a PIN, be sufficient? What are the threat models that make someone get hold of that PIN and then overcome the WebAuthn or push authenticator to leverage the knowledge of the PIN? So I'm looking forward to that discussion with you guys. Then I'll just have to say we love passwordless, and we can't wait for the technology to come through. And if you missed out, don't despair. There is hope. You can swisha, as you say here in Sweden, or Vips, or move to our donation site. We appreciate any support we can get. And since I didn't know what the vote we're going to end up with, here's for redundancies. Yeah, because it could have ended up with something white on black, you know? But you know, he couldn't, but I could source a pink t-shirt for Per. So, not as unique as yours, but very, very limited.
And you want me to wear a t-shirt that says passwordless?
You can do it on day three. Yeah, you can do it on day three. Yeah, it's
worst passwords con ever.